Welcome, everyone. We'll be getting started in just a few moments. Greetings, everyone, and thank you so much for joining us this evening. We are Lost City Books, and we're so very pleased to welcome D.S. Marriott to discuss Before Whiteness. This collection is, in my opinion, very incredible, and I'm so very honored to have the opportunity to speak with the author today. For those of you who are new, we are Lost City Books, an independent bookstore in the heart of Adams Morgan, Washington, D.C., and we specialize in new, used, and rare books. Our new space, which we renovated in 2020, generates engagement and enrichment from the surrounding community, inviting artists, activists, organizers, of course, authors, and educators, many of which are also reflected in our staff from the area to share their unique knowledge and skills. You'll notice when you visit our store that our selection is carefully and lovingly curated by these amazing people who work with us at Lost City Books. So if you have the opportunity and you're in Washington, D.C., we encourage you to come and give us a visit and check out what we've got. My name is Shady Rose, and I am your host for this evening. About our author tonight. Poet and scholar D.S. Marriott was born in Nottingham and educated at the University of Sussex, UK. He's the author of the poetry collections Incognegro, Hoodoo Voodoo, The Bloods, and Duppies. His chapbooks include In Neuter and Lative. His work is sometimes associated with the Cambridge School of Poetry. In his critical review and creative work, Marriott, of Jamaican heritage, draws on postcolonial thought and thinkers such as Frantz Fanon, and is a leading theorist of Afro-pessimism. His critical books include On Black Men, Haunted Life, and Wither Fanon. Wither Fanon studies in the blackness of being. He has taught at many universities and is currently based in Oakland, California. And without further ado, I'd like to welcome you. Hello.
Hi, how are you doing?
We're so pleased to have you here, and thank you so much for joining. I know that our viewers are really excited to hear about Before Whiteness and to learn about your internalized thought process and kind of how this book came to be. So if you would like to, I'd like to invite you to introduce yourself and introduce the book a little bit for us.
Okay, well, my name is David D.S. Marriott. I'm currently teaching at Emory University. This book, Before Whiteness, has just come out from City Lights Spotlights series, and it collects recent work as well as some slightly older work. And I'm very pleased with how it's come out. It has, in terms of the cover, it has a kind of visual representation of the Grenfell Tower, which I don't know if people know about the Grenfell Tower tragedy, which was a kind of large skyscraper which burnt down recently in the middle of London, killing over 80 people, a lot, most of them immigrants, people, brown people and black people of color. So the kind of book in a sense is a kind of part memorialization to that event, but also it's a, I would say, more considered contribution to black music, black art, and black politics more generally. So it has influences ranging from grime music to Carol Walker to recent kind of stories of immigration in both the US and in the UK, and also the kind of consequences of the recent Black Lives Matter protests taking place all over the world. So it's a confluence of many factors.
Thank you. So something that I noticed is that the phrase Afro-pessimism is used, and I think that not many people understand what Afro-pessimism is, unless they've, you know, read Afro-pessimism, the book. And I'd like to clarify a few of the ideas kind of behind Afro-pessimism, and also a few of the ideas around around at least your thoughts on the discussion right now about Blackness and about race across pretty much the Western world, and how that makes its way into your art and into art that you appreciate or have absorbed lately.
Yes. The word Afro-pessimism actually is very much a US term. I think it's traveled, but it's very much a US term. It derives from works by Frank Wilderson, Jared Sexton, and other people. And it might be initially obscure people if they haven't read those works, but basically I think the central question, which is itself an obscure, difficult question, is what does actual blackness mean? What does it represent? What does it signify? And without prejudging or presupposing what that answer might be, Wilderson, for example, goes through a whole range of texts, both critical, theoretical, poetic, visual, to talk about answer that question, as does Jared Sexton. So I would say the pessimistic aspect of that question is whether one should go on considering or trying to consider blackness as simply another form of identity, or whether it actually is singled out, both in its suffering and in its ordeal, for special treatment. And by special treatment, I mean persecution, violation, and hurt. And one of the political consequences of Afro-pessimism is really to shake up the ways in which Black social movements have thought about, you know, reforming the system or trying to integrate into the system. I mean, as James Baldwin rightly puts it, who wants to be integrated into a burning house? So it's about taking up that legacy, and you can see this legacy taken up with people like the Hazy Coats as well as Frantz Fanon. But the point is that we're just running out of patience with the ways in which blackness has been fought up until now, and we need a much more radical reconsideration of what blackness is.
Sorry, I was on mute. I think it's really fascinating too that that especially in the time that we are living in now, where the conversation about the historical struggle and suffering of Black people specifically, but people in color more broadly, in Western communities and Western society, is simultaneously reaching its most honest and most sort of fervent point in the conversation, while also in some corners, especially in the US, as we've noticed with all of this talk about critical race theory, for example, has been being curtailed again. And I'm wondering if parts of Before Whiteness are reflecting on that as well, the importance of the conversation being sort of subsumed by white discomfort and
I mean, the before is both a kind of spatial sense of the word, you know, before being always placed before whiteness, in terms of being judged by it. And the other one is what would it mean to imagine a world of before, you know, whiteness became this kind of global catastrophe for peoples of color, to put it bluntly. And it's not an attempt to imagine a utopia. It's really an attempt to kind of ask the basic question of what it would mean to for Blackness simply to persist and exist in the world without that kind of constant interrogation. And you're right to point out, you know, as soon as it becomes a major two steps forward in terms of Black discourse, Black rhetoric, then there's always a major pushback by the powers that be. And you see this in the debates over critical race theory. But the point is that, I mean, that pushback is produced by a sense of challenge, and I would argue a sense of crisis in what whiteness means itself. And of course, but that shouldn't be the priority here. In terms of writing, something that Toni Morrison said a while ago, you know, it's kind of a radical thing just to say you're going to write not with white people in mind, but you're going to try and address the kind of complexity of a Black readership in terms of where it's coming from, without presuming that one knows or one occupies a common reference point. And that to me is a difficult challenge, and that's what I'm trying to think through in some of this poetry. But again, I'm not claiming to, not claiming any special knowledge or insight into what Blackness is. In fact, what I'm interested in actually is those places, those moments where kind of Blackness ends up as a kind of limited experience or a crisis point in its own imagining of what it is. So what I take from Wilderson and other people like that is the question, you know, the Black, you know, when you're Black, you're not just simply a worker, you're not simply a woman or a man or a they, you're always Black X or Black Y. And the question is why is Blackness always both a subtraction and an excess at the same time, which always confounds what it simply means to go to work, to live, to be happy, to be to occupy social spaces.
Absolutely, and I think that's a really insightful point to explore. I think I would love to hear, if you would, a selection of some of the poems from Before Whiteness to share with our audience.
Okay, well, if you don't mind, I'll be happy to read a couple of poems. I think I'll read one from the other side of the Atlantic, which is inspired by kind of UK grime music and writing, which this one's called Murking After Stormzy. Think of a moment exploding as a pulse leads us on into unaccustomed light. Everyone astonished at the unerring cold of a thousand cellular voices. The panic desensitized by suspicion, the walls bathed in sweat. Bodies in a heap forgotten in the basement. This is no joke, Star. How many yous knows me are in this place? Talk to anyone. Violence is no more or less than beauty. The sudden imploding trace, the realist codes flashing like sirens. There's no one here, so whose song is this? still embracing, still linking the downs that made us give up the towns that made shit one of the seasons. The rain pouring down all the elsewheres and maybe nevers of experience. And here I am, barefoot, bleeding, leaning against a popo so viciously off key. From one imploding moment to the next, the human orphaned from its spirit, where each thing granted is farther off, fenced, and each random zero is beside itself with boredom, still murking, still mired in the never, never. Me, a man singing in the circuits, hearing a voice bored by itself, a voice reserved for nothing. The smoked just too pure for what really matters. When the fix remains too fixed for the expanses, the distances, and passion is the least delirious, and what remains of the junk means that what could not be made good is a still point of heaven. That's how it is. The infinite always dissolving into leaven like ash in celestial fire. The remainder suddenly flooded with stars. In me, a petrol-soaked carnage, its art igniting fires on the streets. And just another poem, slightly shorter one. This poem probably needs no introduction. It's called Lester Young by Washington Square. So Lester Young is a jazz musician, just to speak the obvious. Someday I shall catch my breath, alone in a dark room with the sky clear, clear. I shall listen to the radio playing pennies from heaven in the filthy air. The sky will be washed clean of birds, and a dog will bark just once amid this song of yearning as I pass from the world. In my mouth is curious taste. I shall whisper a word I don't know, a word that means nothing to me as it passes from me into the bright world, a world of desolation as I lie choking on the damp bed while all the years enter the history of sleep, never to come again, except as footnotes to this music rising in the air. Loneliness, disaster, gall. I shall hoard each in this room, pay a price I cannot name, and lose all as light fades on my broken body. The sudden flight of birds will leave the sky clear as they pass from sight, while music rises on dreams laden with longing, breathless in my ear. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Let's talk a little bit about those selections. Something that stands out to me is in the first excerpt that you just read, there was the mention and sort of the pervasive awareness of violence. And the thought about violence and the exploration of violence is, I think, something that features really heavily right now on people's minds as we're faced with not only the consequence of our this nation and many nations' legacy of violence against Black and brown bodies, but the ongoing insidious perpetuation of that violence. And many tend to take that violence and internalize it, but also reject it as an option of resistance to the violence. And in some senses, I kind of, and please, you know, this is just my interpretation, but something that stands out to me from that poem is that the violence is a matter of course. And in a way, so I'd like to hear you kind of speak on that. I'm just riffing a little bit here on my own interpretation.
I mean, I can speak to that. I mean, that's a very insightful comment, Stacey. So so there's the violence of the music and there's violence of language, but allied to all of those things, there's the kind of violence which affects permanently or puts Blackness permanently in a place of danger. So, you know, blackness is a fatal way of being alive, and we don't need to be reminded of that. There's a daily roll call of kind of violences which make that point very, you know, very obvious in a kind of tragic way. But we all know what we're talking about. The point is not to celebrate it, or indeed to go beyond it, but try and analyze it, try and kind of see what's going on there. And it's not about, I don't think one should internalize the violence. I think that one should try and make sense of it. And the thing about poetry or music is that you're trying to put something into a form which can kind of make sense of it, which can contain it. And the music which appeals to me just jumps straight into my psyche. I mean, it grabs you or it doesn't. I mean, I'm not talking about an abstract thing. I'm talking about music which grabs you in a sense. And it does so imperiously. So in a sense, you know, the kind of passions, your own passions and desires can sometimes take violent possession of you in ways which for most people is a good thing. But clearly there's a kind of violence which also radically undoes you and is a threat to your life. And that's something which I think nothing can really compensate for. So the poem is really staging a confrontation between those kinds of violences and the kind of violence of intimacy, or which is already intimate to you, and the kind of violence of the social world, which kind of maps onto that violence in a very destructive way. So, you know, for me, I feel like passion can itself be experienced as a kind of violence, but I wouldn't say that was necessarily a bad thing. And I wouldn't say necessarily that blackness is opposed to that kind of violence. I mean, whenever you listen to the funk or to, for me, jazz or even avant-garde kind of music, something either grabs you or it doesn't, and it grabs you in that way which can't be resisted, is irresistible. And that just makes me actually feel alive, makes me feel alive in a way which is, I think, important. Whereas other forms of violence are ways which try to stop black people from being alive, and is really an enactment which sees blackness as always already dead, and therefore it's kind of puts in a place of permanent execution.
Absolutely, and as a musician, I can definitely relate to the violence of feeling that goes into, you know, I'm a lyricist, mm-hmm. which is pretty right. closely related to a poet.
Yeah.
And similarly for me, you know, when music has exactly that right arrangement of words or that right arrangement of notes and ideas, it mm-hmm. does attach itself to you with violence.
Mm-hmm.
And so I like the way that you just explained the concept of the violence of the different facets of violence and how that interacts with identity and with art.
Yes. Yeah, I mean, I don't know about your taste in music, but or indeed even in painting or what have you, but you know, this kind of the artwork which matters to me is that one which forces me up against my limits, forces me to think differently or feel differently about certain things. I mean, if I'm always already consuming the same thing, it's not really having much of an impact. So kind of like things which push me somewhere, I'm kind of into a realm of discomfort. And that to me is, I don't think violence is the right word, actually. It's more like a force, because violence always has that impression, something hitting something else. But what I'm talking about is something which is more internal to your mind or your psyche or your identity. And I don't think violence is, yeah, that kind of the right word there.
Absolutely. That's an interesting concept to explore too. And when you think about your work as a poet and sort of what that calling means to you and how you express these ideas with your poetry, what are some of the abstractions that come to you, if you can describe them?
Okay. Because you know, I also play music, but when you're talking about poetry, you have to kind of deal with the materiality of the language in front of you. You can't really get around that. And the I would say that what first arises is a kind of rhythm, a kind of insistence, a kind of syntax, which then becomes communicated in terms of words. And then I reflect, and then normally it comes out in a rush. So, and if you read the poems, a lot of them are not written in terms of linear kind of sequences, but kind of down through the page. So that's a kind of rhythmic phrasing of the poem itself. So, so in a sense, that rhythm actually leads to a kind of writing, which itself leads to a kind of meaning, but the meaning doesn't come first. That's, I suppose, a simple point I'm trying to make. I actually don't know what the poem will end up as before I start writing it. I don't end up in the same place from which I began. In a sense, the syntax of language, or whatever, the arrangements between words, the sounds of words, the sounds between words, the spaces between words, will alter what you're able to do. And so you're kind of constantly struggling against that materiality, like a swimmer going up against the tide. And where you end up is kind of up to you.
Very interesting. And you mentioned jazz earlier as something that also creates this feeling in you. And I can't help but note the similarities between what you just described and what I experience when I listen to jazz as well. And I'm wondering if music, if you want to elaborate a little bit on the connection there, how jazz especially, but yeah, how music finds its way into the structure and into the writing and into the work, externalizing itself from you.
Yeah, that's a great question. So, well, I mean, the fundamental thing I think about in terms of Black music, Black poetry, is syncopation. I think it's almost impossible to imagine Black music without syncopation, which is a kind of offbeat in jazz, but it also solicits a kind of call and response as well when it becomes vocalized in terms of various Black forms. So in this book, and also in this new kind of newer stuff I've been writing, I've been thinking about syncopation both in terms of jazz, but also in terms of reggae and dub and all the rest of it, which rely very much on the kind of accentuating the offbeat. And to me, that doesn't lead to a kind of rhythmic monotony. What it leads to is actually a kind of experimentation within a very confined space. That's what I like about it. You're free to experiment, but within a kind of rhythm which has already been laid down. And so the genius, if you like, is how you measure yourself up against that kind of constraint and produce something, improvise something through it or on it. And I mean, what I like about certain jazz musicians is that they seem to be able to occupy spaces between notes in ways which just so beautiful. Miles Davis was kind of John Coltrane, Alice Coltrane. The list just goes on and on and on. The way they occupy a kind of syntax where everybody else is holding down the beat, the offbeats around them, it's just amazing. Excuse me, I've just got. But I would say you can't freely experiment in poetry in the same way as you can in music, because those kind of abstract notes, they can't be mirrored in words. And one of the problems I had in writing some of these pieces, what I was trying to mimic notes, but found it very difficult to do so, because there's other things which interrupt that kind of free experimentation, that free improvisation. So what you try and do is kind of decenter words as much as possible, but you can only do so much, because the syntax of languages really just pull you back in. It's like a center of gravity. You can't really ever get beyond it, if that makes any sense.
It does. And something I would say that is really notable about your work in Before Whiteness, and I'm sure other works of yours as well, is I think one of the core tenets of poetry is an economy of words, right? And by which I mean using your words precisely and using them to evoke specifically the feeling or the experience or the memory that you want to reach for. And that is definitely a significant way that poetry and music differ. Of course, there are many ways, but I'm interested a little bit more in talking about how the distillation process of your poetic writing process works. You know, if you start with, you mentioned starting with a bit of the rhythm and the cadence, and you mentioned how you don't quite know where the poem is going to end until you arrive at the end, right? Yeah. So it sounds like what you're saying is your writing process as you're creating a poem is very experiential and very much about distilling your thoughts and your feelings in the moment of writing.
Yeah, I was very influenced and have been very influenced in terms of the writing of this new work by cadences of speech. And, I'm from the UK, so, you know, in London, the cadence of speech, the kind of the argot which most people speak relies on the kind of black speech. It's kind of black Caribbean accentuation. Everybody uses it, especially people, you know, younger people who are kind of, and it's hard to avoid that those cadences of speech. But I also like poems which get close to the cadence of speech, but aren't just simply speech. I mean, they kind of formalize it as well. So, you know, people like Camus, Braithwaite, or talked about, you know, the necessity of writing in dialect. I don't write in dialect. I have written in patois myself, but I don't think that writing in patois gives a poem any more legitimacy than if you say write in kind of the ordinary cadences of speech, whether you're talking about Georgia or London. But I think the cadence of speech makes the language more sing more better. Whereas, you know, really formal English poems, which a lot of poets do write, black poets, I mean, that to me reads like poetry on the page. And it doesn't have an energy which you get from just listening to ordinary people speak and how inventive they are in terms of the use of slang and dialect. And, you know, I mean, it's just a joy sometimes just to listen to ordinary people speak about themselves and poetry. I'm trying to get some of that energy, make it manifest without reducing it just simply to dialect. Do you know what I mean? So I'm not trying to reproduce this opposition between dialect and formal poetry. Now, that's not really what I'm at, but I'm really interested in that kind of poetry which can which sounds like it's closer to the cadence of the street than the place of the seminar.
Absolutely, I definitely understand what you mean by that, especially because African diasporic vernacular, whether it's African American vernacular or UK African. African UK vernacular, I'm not sure what we call it overseas, it's inherently descended from languages that are built around rhythmic. You know, we have tonal languages, we have languages that are atonal, like English, for example, and then there are a lot of languages another category is being studied of rhythm being a part of language and having a lot to do with the way that ideas and feelings are communicated. Something that comes to mind is in West Africa and other parts of Africa, we have the talking drum. And it's a drum where you squeeze and you drum to match the intonation and the rhythm of a speech. Yeah. And that in itself creates, you know, a community and musical and storytelling experience. So that it does absolutely make sense to me. I'll take a pause really quick because we do have a few questions in the live stream here. And I'll remind our viewers that if you're watching on the live stream and you want to ask a question, you can type it into the comment section and we'll get to it in just a few moments. But I think this is a good time for this question from J. Cameron Carter, who asks, the form of poetry being discussed, a force that can possess, et cetera, strikes me as on the terrain of religion. This fascinates me. the poem as a kind of religious experience. Might you speak to this?
Yes, thank you for that question, Jay. The question that I'm really interested in is rhythm, how it relates to revelation. And you don't have to reduce that question to a question about a musicality, but you know, the question of the verb and how the verb manifests something like a sacred presence or not has always been a concern. I think a lot of black cultural forms, black rituals, and all the rest of it. So speaking in tongues as well as echolalia, I mean, it's just all part of the same mix. But what I'm really interested in is trying to, if you like, withdraw the question of revelation from that of meaning. So what gets announced as sacred doesn't necessarily have to be necessarily a sacred text. It can be a kind of essencing, to use that word, which does not necessarily need to be stated. It can be felt as a force. Again, like we're talking about talking drum. I mean, when it's in certain rituals or ceremonies, that kind of drum itself takes on a kind of sacred character. And so, so the musicality that we've been speaking about has nothing to do with sense necessarily. Sometimes the incapacity of being able to say something is more important than being able to say it, and that can be the kind of the sacred performance.
I feel that I'm beginning to understand, but I want to kind of dig a little deeper into that, because I think that the phrase or the concept of sacredness or religion or religious experiences can so often be conflated with what the majority religious kind of oligarchy will tell us is religious experience. Mm-hmm. And I think the way that looks tends to be, you know, the kind of homogenous Christian experience, to be frank.
Sure.
Whereas there are so many spiritual practices and so many spiritual experiences that are nothing like what that describes. And so many, especially, for example, my family is from Ghana in West Africa, and so many of our traditional religious practices include song, include poem, include storytelling as the central theme. And it's all oral tradition, and it's all included, you know, with drums, with music, but also even if you're just alone in a circle, you know, with other people, you don't have instruments, it's still told in that that rhythmic sort of pulsating way that creates a trance. And something that I noticed in the second poem that you read was that the cadence of the words and the careful selection of the words created that rhythm. I found myself rocking a little bit along with the poem.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, that's what a spiritual experience feels like, is being transported into a common feeling and sharing that. So I'd love to hear a little bit more about, I know that was a long spiel to get to the point, but what I mean is to talk a little bit about how, if you think this has happened, if you've had opportunities to do a lot of readings live, I know we're still in a pandemic, how you experience people reacting to your work and how that kind of has panned out when you're in person or even just how we are now on video.
Yeah, I mean, there's certainly a material difference when you're reading into a space rather than reading to a screen. I much prefer the space, because you're not this kind of vocalization, the timbre of the voice, the cadences, they take on a material presence, which I think the kind of Zoom reading doesn't really convey or can't really capture or contain. That's one thing. But the other thing about it is that each reading, regardless whether it's on screen or in person, dramatizes something different. And so, you know, you can read the same poem on Zoom or in person, or you can read it from one event to another event, and yet come up against a kind of different problematic from when you read it before. And that doesn't mean you're necessarily reading it better or worse. It just means that you're coming up against a different kind of impasse, a different kind of vocalization problem, if you like, or realization that what you didn't know was there. And you only you only experience that in an actual reading. And that's the point. I mean, reading something to yourself when you're, or even reading it back to yourself when you've just written it, it's not the same as performing it to an audience and seeing how that performance is being, in a sense, sent back to you by the audience. Sometimes you see people nodding their heads, sometimes you see people enraptured, sometimes you see people, you know, profoundly bored. It doesn't really matter. They're all forms of communication. But what I'm saying is that each response allows you to experience something different about relations between, say, body and language, and I would say to performance and also knowledge. And you can't really account for that before it actually takes place. In terms of the going back to what you're saying about religion, so, you know, this kind of, I know certain poets who get into a kind of trance-like state during their readings, and the kind of words take them over, and it becomes like a kind of prayer. But it's actually saying of the words is the form of prayer. It's not that they're kind of rehearsing some kind of knowledge, but the actual rhythms of the words take over the body, and the body then responds like a kind of an echo chamber to the way in which the words are being pronounced. And that's a great thing to see. I never quite lose myself in that regard. I think I'm too self-conscious or not conscious enough, I don't know. But either way, it's something which I've seen, but which I don't really, it's conspicuously absent from how I read. I try and, when I read, I try and think about the words as spaces in between and before and after, and try and occupy those spaces in terms of the voice, but it's very hard to know whether that's going to be successful or not.
Okay, I see. I think, no, what you say makes sense. And I definitely also notice that carefulness in your, even just the reading that you've just performed. I would like to switch tracks a little bit. Mm-hmm. I'm not choosing my words very carefully today, clearly. But what I do want to talk about is, and you mentioned a little bit earlier, is that you spent, a lot of these poems are not from the exact same time period in your life, right? They're from sort of an extended period, and a selection of that, the body of work is a selection from different right. periods in time. If you can talk a little bit about sort of the expanse of time that that created these poems in your life and how they became a unified project.
Okay. So yeah, I mean, so that they're bookended by a kind of two traumatic events, as far as I'm concerned. So the book is dedicated to the Starish One. The Starish One is Mark Duggan, who was a young black man who got killed by a police marksman in London several years back. So, I mean, and then the book ends with this long memorial poem to the Grenfell tragedy, fire tragedy. So it's bookended by those two events. And in a sense, that's the span of the poems is a kind of endless filling in and crossing out of my responses to those two kind of experiences. I mean, Mark Duggan was kind of assassinated in some place close to where I knew and where I spent a lot of time in London, and the kind of effects produce a kind of an uprising, which still has repercussions now in terms of black communities' relationship to the state and to the policing in general. People are outraged by it and still are. But the Grenfell tragedy is a slightly different kind of playing out. So yeah, the poetry testifies to it, but it isn't about it. It is an attempt to, again, make write into kind of images of those experiences without reducing them to my experience, because I don't own these things, I'm just speaking to them. And in a sense, both of them, when I think about them, remain kind of an enigmatic eclipse in a kind of total darkness. I cannot imagine what it would have been like to be in that building after the people were told to go back into a kind of burning skyscraper and wait to be rescued, even though we're outside, and then told to go back in, walking back hand in hand. I mean, it's just mind-boggling, that kind of tragedy. But similarly, the Duggan stands for a whole generation. Mark Duggan, the Starish one, stands for a whole generation of men who I kind of knew and grew up with, who've kind of fallen by the wayside because of the various pressures upon them. So a kind of immoralization to that kind of darkness too, which does remain dark to me, not because I don't know it, but because it's like it's difficult to embrace it and with any kind of sincerity or honesty without reducing it to something else. So I don't want my poetry to become catastrophe porn, which is, you know, a kind of tourism of trauma which so many poets engage in. That fills me with an anathema and kind of distaste. Now I want my poetry to be true, and but true in the way in which it speaks, not in the way in which in terms of what it's about.
I understand completely. I like what you said just now about the trauma / tragedy porn concept, and how I think especially the Black experience is these days expected to be put on display. Especially Black pain is expected to be on display for the consumption of non-Black consumers, which naturally and of course reduces it past any truth that might have been in the original expression of pain, mm-hmm. or the expression of joy for that matter.
Right.
And so when you sit down to write about the tragedy, and you're writing your truth about the tragedy, or yes. you're writing your truth about the pain, that in its own way is an incredible resistance to the expectation that your pain should be consumable or marketable, or I really feel like this is the right word, pornographic for yes. the consumer.
Yeah, yeah, no, I totally agree. I mean, there's a deep distaste that I have that kind of writing, but you know, people do pander to it, and it sells books. But the thing is, I'm not sure what you're buying. I'm really not sure what you're buying. Are you buying a kind of con or a game? I don't know. But what you're not buying is any kind of knowledge. I think because you're not really being told what the causes of the pain are. You're just being presented the pain to consume and consume it in a kind of mindless way, or deeply complicit way, which in a sense is pornographic. I agree, it empties pain of any kind of meaning. And when I say meaning, I think pain, somebody else's pain, or is what it renders intelligible, is a limit to what you can know about it. I mean, other people's pain are actually what makes it painful, is the fact that it kind of is hard to express, it's hard to make sense of it, and it's hard for them to also make sense of it. So when you're writing poetry about pain or suffering, the key is to be mindful of the limits of what you can do.
I this puts me in mind, we have a few more minutes, so I'd like to ask a few more questions, but I see that we have another question from the live stream here. James Goodwin says, I wonder if you could speak more to what you mentioned earlier as the materiality of poetry, and whether it is or could be a problem for language as communication, analysis, criticism form.
Well, thank you, James. It's a lovely question from you. So the materiality of language can be approached in many different ways. So I mean, you could talk about it in terms of, you know, morphemes, phonemes, syntax, you know, you could talk, you could the beginnings and ends of words, you know, whatever, wherever you want to go. They all have kind of depth and what I call a gravitational pull, which will oscillate between the kind of syntactical and semantic functions of language. So, you know, how you mean, but also how you show meaning. And in terms of criticism, I was trained as a young person in terms of the reading of poetry. So I know how to parse a sentence. I know how to identify the kind of parts of language which go to make up certain words and how they work. I'm not sure everybody has that training. So when you read poetry, you can't simply read it as a kind of propositional form. You need to be able to realize that the kind of materiality precedes the sense you make of the line, and also produces something which is beyond sense at the same time, something which empties out sense. And that's what I mean by the materiality. It goes both before and after that kind of sense. And it's always in advance of the concepts which you can kind of chase it. So think about that. It's as a kind of hare you're pursuing through the undergrowth, which you can never kind of quite catch. The problem I have with a lot of poetry as interpretation is it simply reduces poetry to a kind of thematics. So it's nothing but kind of themes, which are then either disputed or affirmed, rather than understood in terms of this, what I'm calling this materiality. And I mean, you'll know, recognize what I'm about to say insofar as I think that materiality must necessarily be a limit to what we can know about poesis, about poesis as a process, but also as an activity. And that's a good thing. That's where I see poetry being politically most radical and most liberating, because it does simply resist what passes for common sense, and racial common sense in particular. So going back to what I was saying before, the poetry which I like makes nothing happen, but nothing is perhaps the most radical thing it can make happen as such.
I think that's very interesting, because many maybe expect, especially in contemporary times, many expect that poetry, art, music, etc., should be overtly designed to influence and overtly designed to align itself with non-artistic ideas, if that makes sense. So
sure.
For to use a very flat example, you know, people on the internet really like to harass celebrities if they don't speak up about insert political or cultural phenomenon that's happening. You know, they'll go on to Beyonce's Twitter and say, why haven't you talked about the war in Ukraine? You know, mm-hmm. And I think it's very interesting to how this expectation has gained so much traction in the public eye, where sort of direct commentary is expected, or political affiliation, you know, direct political affiliation is expected from the work. And mm-hmm. I wonder if, and I don't know if you think the same or feel the same way, but I wonder if that indicates that the average person is losing an artistic and literary analytic sense that allows them to draw from a piece of work the subtleties and the political and social and cultural milieu of the artist and of the work itself, and rather now are expecting instead for artists to kind of emblazon their beliefs and affiliations on the surface of their work. Does that make sense? It was kind of convoluted.
Yeah, no, I understand the question. But, you know, I would just begin by saying, I mean, I'm not sure what value having Beyonce speak to war serves for anybody. I mean, it's one thing if she addresses it in a piece of music, which I can understand, but for her to just to come out and say something about the war, I'm not sure what value that would have, or what more added value that would have apart from the fact that she's a celebrity, in which case it's kind of a superficial idea of what radical speech is. The second thing I would say is I'm not sure about whether people have lost the sense. It's just that, you know, I mean, just speaking from the point of view of America, I mean, the where are the Black radical voices that can bring you up against the limits of the status quo? I mean, where are they? What are they saying? I mean, where are, I just don't know where they are. And in a sense that, so, you know, celebrity has kind of filled that kind of vacuum, which is a vacuum of the political classes themselves, and especially the radical kind of legacies, which are of the 1950s, 1960s. I just don't see any kind of comparable kind of speech. And compare it to Malcolm X or even Martin Luther King, I mean, just there's just no comparison. Just like mountains versus hills. I mean, it's just crazy. The lack of a kind of sustained resonance, talking about cadences of speech, by which we can make sense of the world and what's going wrong with it. But, you know, that's why I look to poetry and fiction and art, because they make clear to me that there is a way of speaking, a way of making evident, not just simply new forms of representation, but they're challenging what I would call the racism of representation itself. So the ways in which Black voices are uniquely silenced or forbidden or prohibited from speaking about their own experiences, or indeed commenting on the world as is, without fundamentally being marginalized or deemed inferior or irrelevant. So, you know, those artists do their work, they do their job when they question the limits of representation. I don't expect them to do anything else. I don't need Beyonce to come out and say the war is bad. I mean, you know, I don't need her to do that. But what I do would like her to do is produce a kind of music which is adequate for the war against Black life, and in a way which isn't just yet another kind of superficial version of that war. But whether that will happen or not, I don't know.
I think that's an excellent point. The role of the artist in conveying that idea and that experience to their fans and to their viewers, listeners, what have you, has always been immaterial, but and especially recently, we're looking at what you said earlier was the racism of representation.
Yeah.
And I thought that was an incredibly apt phrase because the struggle to be represented at all in media and to have our truths actually broadcast to broader communities and outside of our own has, of course, almost, of course, been co-opted by the sort of larger media need to control the Black narrative and to control even what the public might see as Black truth. So where what you said earlier about, you know, we don't have those voices that have that impact and have that societal and social rhythm and cadence where the people fall in step with those voices. I think it's very true, and it's really interesting. And I cannot claim to have necessarily a solution to that, or necessarily to have a more insight than that. I can see it.
Yeah, I just don't. I mean, I don't mean to end up on a pessimistic note, but I remember walking around the streets of Harlem in the late 80s, early 90s, and people on soapboxes proclaiming, you know, everything from kind of Black messianism to, rental strikes and all the rest of it, but they're doing it in a kind of stridency and with a speech of utter conviction, which is, you know, indifferent to whether the message is either heard or intelligible. What matters is, you know, the strength of the message itself. It comes from the heart. It speaks the truth as you see it and without compromise. And that kind of saying, that kind of speaking is something which, God, I do miss it. I really do miss it. And I don't hear it often enough. But that kind of knowledge, it will always come from the streets. It won't come top down. And that's just my belief. That might be my own limitation, but that is my belief. which is why I want my poetry to return to the cadence of the street, because I think that's where the kind of future of poetry is actually being written. So.
Absolutely. And I don't think that's a pessimistic note at all, really. I think it's honest and, to me, feels hopeful because, you know, the voices from the streets are finally making their way into the light again and being protected more and more by leaders in the Black community, especially, you know, people like yourself who are positioned to respect and uplift that voice. So thank you for that. And thank you for this incredible discussion. We've reached our time, but I'd like to ask you for our viewers at home, if you can let us know where we can keep up with your work moving on from now.
Okay, Stacey. Well, first of all, thank you so much for your gracious attention to the poetry and for your time and effort in terms of dealing with kind of difficult poetry off the bat. I appreciate the gesture, and I appreciate you for hosting this event. In terms of the work, yeah, well, the City Lights book is now out and you can be ordered on Amazon, so I'm very happy about that. And I have a future work from Omnidawn coming out next year, and also a more critical book coming out from Stanford again to launch this new series I'm editing called Inventions. So I'm very excited about that. So people will probably get sick perhaps of the voice, but I, you know, there's so many great poets out there and so many great writers and thinkers, and it's a good time, I think, to be reading and writing Black poetry. There's so many, and so many good poets, and I'm excited, just glad to read, if not write.
Absolutely, I agree. And thank you so much again. For those of you watching at home, if you don't already have your copy, you can order directly through lostcitybookstore.com and grab a copy of Before Whiteness. I promise that you will not regret it, or maybe you will, and that'll be okay too. You know, you need to feel hard feelings sometimes. So I hope that you all enjoyed this conversation as much as I did. Thank you again so much, Professor Marriott, for joining me tonight. And I wish you the best evening in the world.
Okay, thank you. Have a good